that way.
It's like it's like going through an obstacle course and you're both like pulling each other like this.
When you
like,
go through something together, it's better when you're going through with somebody you know. You know. And I never felt alone, you know, during that time. And
I'm gonna call this topic the bromance for the ages.
The bromance. You know, I love Eddie. Eddie. You know, I don't know if you're looking at this or not.
Text me a picture of you and Eddie together. Yeah, yeah, I'll make that the thumbnail. So let me, we kind of brushed over about your service in the military. So what happened? I know you got on deployment. You went to handle business when Katrina happened.
Yeah, several hurricanes, actually.
Yeah. So tell me about it. What happened?
So my Army time, so whenever I do anything, my heart and my brain has to be involved. I have to want to do it, you know. So when it comes to the military, I don't know if I really wanted to do the military. I think I did it because of necessity or because it was the easy thing to do. But I didn't give my all to the Army. And that, you know, my actions or, you know, basically I didn't give what I was supposed to give.
But you're like your time ran out, right? Basically.
Yeah, I did your whole 6 years. Yeah. Actually I did 7 years of National Guard duty and then I did 1 year of inactive duty. So I did 8 years altogether.
Okay.
So from 2002 through 2010 I was in the Army National Guard.
Okay.
And I did my time. I did everything. I did a lot of community involvements. I did hurricane duties. I got deployed in 2006 to go to Iraq. But the funny story, I didn't want to go to Iraq. You know, Jason was little. You know, actually, I'm sorry, it wasn't 06, it was in 05.
Marissa was about to be born.
And that's what really changed my mind because I actually volunteered to go to Iraq.
Oh.
And I was at Fort Hood. I was at Fort Hood for like a month or so. And it dawned on me, I'm like, man, I'm going to try to get out of it, you know, by about my medical history. I had a heart murmur. I told the doctor about it. And they just basically gave me the option to still go as long as I signed a waiver or stay. And I decided to stay. So that's what it boiled down to. I basically bitched out. You know, I was a scared guy to go out there. That's the truth. But that's because I also didn't want to miss Marissa's birth. So
yeah, true.
Yeah.
And so let me ask you, it was honorably discharged, all that kind of stuff, right?
No, I was still in the Army. I meant around
2010.
Right. Oh yeah, no, yeah. Yeah, it was honorable discharge.
That's how it ended.
Yes.
But I wanna switch gears and focus on like something that actually interests me and it may not be interesting to you, but I want to know.
Yeah.
I want to know about like the friendship that defines all friendship. Because to me, and this is from my perspective outside looking in, I think that Eddie is your best friend.
Yes.
So tell me about how did you meet him? How did you guys like bond and like how did that? Because like it feels, because one of those things that you always hear that people say and throw around is like it's actually hard to make friends as an adult. So tell me about the friendship of whatever. I have no name for it yet.
Yeah. So I played football all through past school. He played football. Actually.
Wait, you met in high school?
Yeah, we were in high school together.
I didn't know.
He was a year younger than I was. So when I was in 10th grade, I had a class. It was Spanish honors. It was like Spanish 1 and 2. It was Spanish for native speakers.
Huh.
It was one of the hardest classes that I've ever taken.
Right.
And he was in that class. And he was a little kid, man. He was a scrawny little kid. His voice hadn't yet gotten deep yet. And on Thursdays, you know, I was in JV, so on Thursdays we played football and we had to wear a tie.
Hmm.
We had to wear a tie game day, always. That was a tradition at past school. And one day he walked up to me and he goes, "Hey, man," you know, he's like, "Hey, man." You know, his voice was still not deep. He goes, "Do you think I should play football?" I'm like, "Dude, hell yeah, man. You should play football, man. It's like the best thing that you could ever do is play football."
Okay.
And he goes, "All right, man." And he ended up, you know, trying out for the team and actually became a very good defensive player. He was a linebacker.
Hmm.
At the start of him playing, I think he was probably like a defensive back. but he was a very aggressive player, one of the best hard-hitting guys out there. But he was real good friends with Edgar. Him and Edgar were actually best friends, or one of good friends, a group of friends, Serge Ortiz and all them. So I knew him through that, but we weren't close. Me and Eddie were not close.
Okay.
In fact, Edgar, Ivan, you know, Serge Ortiz, Eddie, they were the popular kids. You know, they were in the clique. Me, I was more into girls. I was always with Leanne. I was never really involved with. I mean, I knew a lot of the guys, but, you know, I just never really partied with them or whatever. And they were a year younger than I was, too. So, anyways, we played football. And, you know, I left past school and, you know, I went on with my life. And, you know, I started getting into the dental marketing. And in 2004, he was in Iraq. He was in the Marines. He was in Fallujah. He was going through hard stuff. And he came back from his deployment to go back to work, and he was working in the dental marketing as well. Oh. Same thing, yeah.
So In fact, here's the way it happened.
Annabelle called me and told me, hey, this guy just left to Iraq. We don't know if he's gonna come back. We don't know if he's gonna want to come back to work at this clinic. Do you want to apply? And I'm like, sure. So I applied and I got the job. So I essentially got the job because he got deployed.
Oh.
And when he came back, they all told me, the guy that went out there, you know, he's in the Marines, blah, blah. I didn't know it was Eddie. When they came back from Iraq, it was Eddie. And, you know, we weren't close or nothing like that, but I knew who he was, and I certainly respected him, you know, because he was in Iraq and he was in the Marines. You know, he was, to me, always a cool kid, you know. And when he came back, I remember he was wearing this pink shirt. So, Eddie, if you're looking at this, he was wearing a pink shirt. And it had a helicopter on it. And he was, like, chiseled. I mean, he was good looking.
He was yacked.
He was...
Certified badass.
In Spanish, you say mamado, man. He was great looking. And I was very nervous to talk to him because, you know, I was wearing these wrinkled-ass scrubs, you know, dirty tennis shoes. And he was just dressed nice, you know, badass haircut. And I go, hey, man, how you doing, Eddie? You know, what's going on? How you been? You know, and he was very serious, you know, still, you know, that deployment mindset. And it was real quick. We said hi. And then on his first day back, you know, he came in and we just started talking, man. We just really got close. I mean, we hit it off. You know, we had the same, you know, interests and stuff like that. And through work and, you know, through our history of going to past school and playing football, we just had a lot of things in common. And we knew a lot of the same people. So I think because of that, you know, and we had a lot of fun. I mean, there was a lot of things that I can't mention here that we did. It was just fun, dumb. You know, and because of Eddie, actually, he brought me through a very hard time in my life. You know, when I was working a lot, he always told me, Carlo, we're gonna do it, man. We're gonna make it. You know, you see these houses. We drive by these nice houses.
That's gonna be us.
Mansions. Yeah. He said, look, you're gonna live there one day. He made me believe that when I had no faith, no imagination, no motivation, no
ambition.
No, I had the ambition and the motivation. I just didn't have the imagination, the vision to say, yeah, I'm going to live there. I'm going to have a big house one day. I'm going to have my own house one day. Because at the time, me and Leanne were going through a rough time.
The apartments and everything.
We're in the apartments, you know, just a lot of debt, a lot of stuff. But Eddie was always able to make me feel like, you know what? We're gonna do it. We're gonna make it. We had our business together, and you know we did very well. He taught me a lot. I always looked up to him.
So let's go over the resume of what happened. Like there was the dental place, and then there was y'all were independent. Right.
We worked for a dentist. So we were just working for one dentist,
like a subcontract type thing.
No, we were employees. We were getting paid like $8 an hour. I was getting paid like $8 or $9 an hour. He was probably getting paid like $12 an hour because you know he had been doing this for a long time. And then Eddie was like, you know what, we could do this on our own. So we left, and then we started subcontracting for different practices.
Mm-hmm.
And we did that for a while.
I made more.
Got paid way and then, more. And then we met this one doctor, Dr. Z, and he was different than any other dentist that we'd ever talked to, and he wanted things big. So we stuck with him.
And y'all basically became employees of them, and then y'all were like...
Eventually, we went from being our own business to being employed with them because they were paying us really good. And we both worked for Rodeo Dental, you know, for a long time. And we did very well. I learned a lot from Eddie. Eddie, like, he, you know, he had the experience, you know, and I think I had more of just the push and, you know, just making sure
that did y'all like compliment each other?
We did, because he was very good. He you know, he's still very good. Eddie's awesome when it comes to PR work. You know, he has the image, you know, very well dressed, very slick, very, he knows what to say.
Right.
Whereas I do too, but I mumble around a lot. You know, I can't get my words right, but I have that ethic.
You're also long-winded ethic. A little.
But yeah. I'm very work ethic oriented. So we complimented, and where we kind of, you know, he had the image and then I had the do, and, you know, we helped each other out. We worked very well, you know, together. So,
cause yeah, what else did y'all do together? Did you guys both do MMI together or just you?
Yeah. You know,
yeah, both did MMI together and Sears together. And like, it just felt like you guys were like,
yeah. So I got him on MMI, cause when we were doing the marketing thing, you know, you still need a full-time job to make sure that, you know, you do good, because, you know, a business sometimes takes a while to get through, you know, to go. And yeah, he worked at MMI with me. He was there for a while. He did very good there. And then he's the one that convinced me to work at Sears with him as a part-time job, yeah. You know. So I did that. We did that together. And another friend of ours also did that. So a lot of our lives, you know, kind of, we revolved around each other.
Yeah.
Working together, that kind of thing. Our families and stuff like that, you know, we were just really close like that. So, you know, like I said, if it wasn't for him, I don't know if I would be where I am today. You know, in terms of 2005, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I mean, all those years, you know, it was that we were kind of going through certain things together. And then, you know, his mindset, his ambition became my ambition, and his vision became my vision. And we just kind of helped each other out that way.
It's like it's like going through an obstacle course and you're both like
holding each other like this. When you go through something together, it's better when you're going through with somebody you know,
Yeah.
And I never felt alone, you know, during that time.
I'm going to call this topic the bromance for the ages.
The bromance. You know, I love Eddie. Eddie, you know, I don't know if you're looking at this or not.
Text me a picture of you and Eddie together.
Yeah,
I'll make that the thumbnail.
Yeah. You know, I don't know if Eddie's looking at this or not, but we actually haven't talked in a while. You know, though we had a little falling out.
That's news.
Yeah. You know, I mean, I take full responsibility for it. You know, there's a lot of things that I probably could have done to avoid, you know, certain things. But I certainly do feel responsible for why he doesn't want to talk to me or whatever. But, you know, if you are looking at this, man, I love you, man, and I miss you. I hope, you know, we could, you know, talk again one day. You know, I regret a lot of things that I've done, but you know, I wish we could talk. You know, you could reach out to me and, you know, we could talk, man. I love you and hope you're not mad that I'm talking about this stuff.
All right, we're gonna wrap this up here. Sure. As usual, I guess that's going to be the thing. I'm going to do silly questions at the end.
Oh, wait, we have to do the Facebook questions too, man.
Oh, right. Shit. You know what?
I can't forget about that.
I can't forget about the Facebook questions. Yeah. Right, let's go to the Facebook questions.
I forgot what they were.
And we're going to run through that, the silly questions, yeah. And then we'll call it the podcast.
Cool, man.
So if I can find the Facebook questions, where's it at? Here we go. Found him. All right.
Yeah.
So Ray Osorio.
You know him?
No, not someone I know for sure, but he's in the Kind of Funny community.
Cool.
He asked, what's your favorite Disney princess?
Is his name Ray?
Huh?
Ray? Oh, hey. Ray. So, Ray, my favorite Disney princess has to probably be, you know, I recently saw Moana.
Oh.
Moana.
Okay.
And she was kind of sexy, man. So I don't know if that's kind of perverted or not. But
no, there was on the Kind of Funny, when the Game Over Greggy show, their very, very first topic of the very first episode was Disney Princess Fuck List.
Oh, okay. Wow.
And that's why he's probably asking us.
Okay, well, Moana, I just recently saw Moana. You know, a lot of those, the original Disney princesses, they seem like they're like stuck up, you know, except for maybe Cinderella. She's probably more.
Pocahontas wasn't really that.
Pocahontas is a little bit more humble. Pocahontas.
Damn. Dude, that's so fucked up.
But Moana, man, she's thick in the right places, man.
As a separate side note to that, as the two of us, were at a sneak peek of Mulan. Okay. We watched Mulan.
Wow, that was a long time
ago. We watched Mulan before it was out.
You remember that? Because yeah. I was young. I remember
you running around the theater.
They made us run. Yeah, they made us run. Yeah, wow. I forgot about that. It was at the
Palace.
No, it wasn't at the Palace. Was it
Sundance?
Sundance Square.
Sundance 11?
11, yeah.
Really? I thought it was, for some reason, I remember it being Palace. But oh, yeah. I remember that. I was like some MC guy at the front with the microphone.
It was a DJ. He was a radio DJ.
Yeah.
We won the tickets. I don't even remember how we got the tickets.
But I saw Mulan before everyone
else. We saw Mulan. We heard Christina Aguilera's beautiful voice. You know, she
and what's her song. Name? What's no? There's another person that sang that song. The Black Christina Milian.
Yeah, she was. That's right.
Yeah.
Wow, man, you have a good memory. Wow.
I said in the last episode, I remember the weirdest stuff.
Yeah.
I have like random memories of random things that just doesn't really have no consequence, but I remember it. Miriam, however you said, Medium.
Medium, our cousin, shout out.
She asked, who was your first love?
Who was my first love? You know, you could use that in the context of, you know, a relationship with another girl. But, you know, I think I would say my mom was my first love in that I remember when I was real little, very young, man, 3 or 4 years old, I remember telling her, Mom, you're pretty, you know. I always loved her hugs. I always, to this day, I always love the way she smells. I remember when we were real little, when we were young, like, I don't know, second, third, fourth grade, she'd come home from work, and she'd been working, like, all day, and she would just have, like, this smell. I don't even think it smelled good, but it was just a smell, and I always remembered her smell. I remember her hands. I always remember Mom's hands, and when it was always time for Christmas, New Year's, when we were freaking poor back in the day, she always had a way to look good, makeup and her clothes, her jewelry. It was probably fake jewelry, but to this day, she's amazing. She's beautiful. You know, I love smelling her and seeing her. We went to go see this guy named Adal Ramones this past Friday, and she looked beautiful, you know. So my mom, I think, is always going to be my first love.
Okay. Kiko is trolling on Facebook.
Oh, yeah, Keeks. What's up, Keeks? I hope you're looking
for some odd reason, he says, can you see Louis still?
See Louis?
Yeah, it says, can you see Louis still? I don't know what that means and why he spells it like that. But whatever that means.
Oh, I do know what he's talking about. You're going to laugh.
Okay.
Okay. And I hope you don't cry. But when we were young.
Oh, okay.
We would mess with you.
Yeah.
We would always make Louis cry. Because
I remember this now.
Jimmy kind of came up with this. We would be at the house on Lilac Street, and you know, you were always high strung. You were always like, you know, the details mattered to you. You know, everything had to have his order. So we would mess with you, and Jimmy would be like, "Hey, do y'all see Louis? Where's Louis at?" And you'd be like, "I'm right here." And we'd be like, "And I'd go along with him again. Yeah. I don't know. Oh yeah, I guess he disappeared, man. I don't know." And you would cry and cry.
I remember that. Yeah,
like,
yeah.
You would get mad. You would hit us like, "I'm right here. Like I'm right here." You know. And so that's what he means. Yeah. So that's a good one, Kiko. I can't believe you remember that. That's pretty funny.
And I remember y'all making Kiko cry too. That one.
I don't remember that, man.
We're gonna drop that one then. Yeah, let's drop it. All right. Let's see. Also, do your balls flush down the toilet if you flush sitting down?
Not yet, but it's getting there because I could kind of feel the cheese spots from the water coming up. So it's getting there.
And last but not least, do you like Trump's wall idea and who's gonna pay for it?
Who's that? Oh my God, was that him?
It says Keeks. It's all Keeks.
You know, I could get very political. I've been keeping up with a lot of stuff, but here's the thing, and everybody. That's for the wall. That's a great. I think it'll be a good way to bring business and jobs and make people rich and stuff like that. But
infrastructure spending.
Let me tell you something. Yeah. We have fencing. We have walls. We have different things already on the border that have helped reduce the amount of people that cross over illegally. Can people still come out illegally? Yes, but let me tell you why. It's that theory and the concept of. Why do we have locks on doors? who is it meant to keep out? Right? If you walk up to a door and you try to open it and it's locked, any honest person will turn away and walk away a different direction. A dishonest person does what?
They'd want to get in there.
They figure out a way to pick the lock or get through that door. Same thing goes for that wall. No matter how many sensors you put on it, no matter how deep you dig it, no matter what you do, there's going to be someone that's going to figure out how to get around that or how to get through it or how to do whatever they want to do, because bad people do bad things. And that's so technology continues to get better every day. And I imagine that it's going to take years to complete this 2,000-mile wall that they're wanting to make. It's a waste of tax dollars, I think. And it's not who the U.S. is. Even the meanest Republicans, even some of those are saying that that's the wrong thing to do. So that's my answer to that. Sorry.
And what's Tony puts a meme
oh
up.
My God.
Cash me outside.
Cash me outside. How about that?
How about that? Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see. Shout out to Tony. All right. Some similar questions. Randomly, I just pulled up from a webpage on the internet. So have you ever been in a car accident?
Have I not been in a car accident? Yes. Yes, I have. My first car wreck was with Juan. We were driving the brown Chevy. What was it? I forgot what it was, but we were driving and it felt like it was slow-mo and we did like a half 180, like a 90 degree skid.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. It was cool, but it was scary at the time. Yeah, my first accident.
What's the weirdest prank you've ever been done?
Talking about Eddie. Eddie pulled the prank on me when we worked at any job, MMI, Sears, the dental office. Every time that I'd be in the restroom pooping in the stall, he would always get a crap load of paper towels, get them wet, and he would throw them at me. And it would always hit me.
Oh, God.
And then when disgusting. I would try to do that to him, I would always miss or whatever. So those are the coolest pranks that we would do.
Best compliment you ever received?
You know, I don't know, man. I've, you know, probably with a girl. Oh, that was nice.
That was cute.
Yeah. Oh, that was cute. That's cute. Yeah.
Inside yeah. joke. Inside joke. what's the first thing you think about when you wake up in the morning?
Shit. You know, I don't know. I don't think about anything other than I got to piss or I got to brush my teeth or I got to get ready for work another day, another dollar.
If you could be any age for a week, what would it be?
Probably any age for a week. I mean, probably one of my younger years when there was no responsibility, no stresses. Life was fun. Probably, I don't know, 9, 10, maybe. Those are the cool times, man.
All right. What's the longest you've ever gone without sleep?
I think it was a full 24 hours in the military. And it was the crappiest time, man. It was some training, an FTX training. We were outside and it was cold. And, you know, even if I wanted to sleep, I couldn't. It was a little bit over 24 hours.
Damn.
Yeah.
All right. And last question. Do you have a question for me?
You know, the first part is, you know, I like what you're doing. You know, I like that you're doing this. You know, you're doing your interviews. I'm hoping that you find something good with that. And interviewing Juan and myself, maybe you learned a little bit about yourself too. And then, you know, of course, of me. But
well, I like the idea. I like the idea of like archiving.
Yeah.
Someone's story. Like, yeah. If it's on the internet, it'll be there forever.
Forever.
Yeah, kind of thing. Cloud. It's in the yeah. So I like that.
My question to you is, you know, how do you see yourself in 5 years from now?
How do I see myself in 5 years from now? So. That's one thing I've been asking myself since like 2008. And so I don't know how things pan out as far as where my life takes me. I always just imagine that somehow, some way I get into like film production or something like that. I don't necessarily know if graduating from UTA is a thing that's in my cards, because I'm going, and I'm actually, the thing is, my current job is prohibiting me from actually going full time. Oh, I'm part time. Okay. So at the rate I'm going, it's going to take way too long. So I might.
How long have you been going to school for?
Since like 10 years now. Yeah, so.
But let me ask you this. Now it's my time to ask you questions.
All right.
You know, you're a very smart guy, and then you know you have a very good memory to retain a lot of information.
Right.
You understand concepts, processes. You get it.
Right.
I think that I'm not as smart as you are. I don't think that I'm smart, but I have a lot of common sense.
Right.
And here's the thing. I think that if I was to go to school, I could achieve graduating within 10 years. And I'm not that smart. But I think what it has to do here is work ethic. For example, you know, setting this up in the morning, you know, getting ready for an interview, editing, doing all these things. That takes work ethic.
Yeah.
But it's because you have an interest in doing it and you love doing this.
Because I want to do it.
You want to do it.
Yeah.
So with school, obviously, maybe you don't. Maybe you're burned out or maybe it's just not something that you want to do. But you've been doing it. You've invested a lot of time. And my advice to you and anybody listening to this, if you want to make any, put any comments on this, you already invested so much money, so much time. I could just imagine that you're probably about, I don't know, 20, 30 hours away.
Yeah, mid-20s.
So if there's any reason, the best reason to just finish it
is to finish it
because of everything that you've already put into it. And to make mom and dad proud and to make me proud and to make Juan proud. And not that we're not proud of you already, it's just that, you know, for certain people, and I know it's going to sound pretty crappy, but there are certain expectations for certain people, you know, and if you want to be honest, like if you were to put me and you, you know, as far as education goes, there's a bigger expectation on your part to get to a master's or to a PhD. Carlo, oh my God, he got a bachelor's. Oh God, good job. You know, but if you say Louis, oh, he got his bachelor's. Oh, well, you know, it's good. Keep going. You know, because do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That there is an expectation. Since you were little, and maybe that was a lot, but you know, I'll leave you with, you know, I hope that you do get your degree. I really do, because I know that you could do it. You just got to put your mind to it.
All right. So, well, thanks, man.
I love you, man.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that was another episode of the Musing with Menchaca Show. So what did you think? Be sure to leave a comment below with any suggestions for feedback or any questions I should be asking my guests. Carlo, thank you very much
thank you for
doing this podcast.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. So let's see, like, share, subscribe, Twitter, PSN, all that stuff. It's all on screen. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for making us a part of your day. I'm your host, Luis, signing out.